Welcome to this series on F-Sharp, where we're going over concepts to help you get started building F-Sharp applications. In this video, we're going to take a look at how you can use loops, conditional expressions, and pattern matching to control the flow of execution inside of your application. As a reminder, any code that you see in this video can be found at aka.ms/fsharp-101-samples. Let's get started. The first concept we're going to look at are loops. Loops are a way of performing operations in a continuous or repetitive manner, such as iterating over a collection like we saw in the previous video, or performing an operation while a condition is true. The two main types of loops in F-Sharp are for loops and while loops. Let's take a look at some code to see what those look like. The first loop we're going to take a look at are for loops. There's for to and for in loops. A for to loop sets starting and ending points. The loop starts from the beginning and performs an operation until it gets to the end. In this case, I'm going from 1 to 3 and printing out each number. To perform an operation in reverse, use down 2. As you can see, I went from 3 down to 1. For in loops don't rely on a starting and an ending point. Instead, they perform operations as they iterate over our collection. In this example, I iterated over my to-do list and turned every element into uppercase. On their own, loops may not seem much different than map or iter built-in functions that we saw previously. However, they can be extremely useful when generating collections. Take a look at this example where I use a for loop to create a new list of to-dos that are in uppercase. The other kind of loop are while loops. While loops don't rely on a starting or ending point or even a collection. Instead, they perform actions while a condition is true. In this example, I'm taking inputs from the console, and as long as the input is not the letter Q, my program will continue to run. As you can see, the console kept waiting for input until I input the letter Q. The next concept we're going to look at are conditional expressions. Applications are just a series of instructions that are executed in sequential order. However, based on certain conditions, your application may have to behave differently. That's where conditional expressions come in. Let me give you an example. Let's say you wanted to know if you needed to take an umbrella with you. If you look outside, you might ask yourself, is it sunny? If so, you don't need one. If it's cloudy, maybe. And if it's raining, yes. Conditional expressions work in a similar way. Another scenario where conditional expressions can be handy is when handling exceptions or errors in your application. Let's take a look at some code to see what conditional expressions look like. In this example, I have a function that takes in a file name. Depending on the extension, it'll print out a different message to the console. The format for conditional expressions is if the condition you want to check, then, and the action you want to take. You can use elif to check additional conditions. Else is used as a catch-all. If none of the previous conditions match, execute the code defined after else. When we try out this code, you'll see that we'll get different results. This is a script file, this is a source file, and this one can't be processed. To handle exceptions, you can use something like the try with expression, where you try to perform some action, and if it returns an exception or error, handle the error. In this example, I have a division function. If the operation is successful, it will return some value. Otherwise, handle the exception and return none. You'll see that in this case, it's going to be successful. But in this case, it will just tell me you can't divide by zero. The last concept, and probably one of the most used features in F-Sharp, is pattern matching. Pattern matching leverages the power of the compiler to make sure and enforce that you're handling behavior correctly throughout your application. You can pattern match on different types like integers, tuples, collections, records, and discriminated unions. Let's take a look at what pattern matching looks like. In this example, I want to handle the way I send a message. I have a discriminated union with different contact methods, and then I have a function called sendMessage, which takes in a message and a contact method. Inside of my function, I use a match expression to look at each of the patterns for contact method and send a message depending on which contact method is used. As you can see, With pattern matching, you can deconstruct and get access to values contained by your types. For example, in voicemail, I can deconstruct the phone number record and access the code and number values. When I send a message, you'll see that my function handles the behavior differently depending on the contact method. This case, it's mailing it. This other case, it's sending an email. And finally, it's leaving a voicemail. So far, it's very similar to conditional expressions, but here's where the compiler comes in. Let's say that I want to add a new contact method, such as SMS. If we now try to define send message, you'll see that it warns me that one of my patterns isn't handled correctly. Therefore, I'd have to account for the SMS scenario in my send message function. Now, I could ignore the warning, but that would introduce bugs into my application. Therefore, the compiler is guiding me to writing correct code. In this video, we saw how you can use loops, conditional expressions, and pattern matching to control the flow of execution inside of your application. As you continue to use these patterns, like collections and records and pattern matching, your application is going to continue to grow. In the next video, we're going to take a look at how, as your application grows, you can organize your code using modules. See you in the next video.